developer betas for iOS 14 have been out for some time. Another third public beta has also gone live. So should you install iOS 14 on your phone? If you don't have a secondary iPhone or an iPad, I won't recommend you installing these betas on your primary devices. As stable as betas have been this year, they are still not the final version of the software and there are a lot of things that can go wrong. Now I know many of you are curious to look at what the new version of iOS offers. So if you want to look at some of the major changes that iOS 14 brings along, keep watching this video. Hey guys, it's Saga from TecWorkZ and I have been using the developer beta of the iOS 14 on my iPhones so I can show you guys its new features. I know I'm again a bit late with this video, but I didn't want to make a video straight away outlining just few of the changes and features that Apple has mentioned in their keynote. I wanted to use these features for some time before I could show them to you guys and see if I can find a few hidden ones if I dig deep. Now there are a ton of new features on iOS 14 and I don't think it is possible for me to go through all of them in one video. So in this one, we are going to look at some of the major game changing features which I feel are important and we will also look at some of the changes which I don't feel have been covered well enough by others. So let's get started. With this new version of iOS, Apple has brought on some big features starting with widgets. Apple is finally letting us add widgets to the home screen of our iPhones. All apps are still anchored to the top left, so you can't just put the widgets anywhere you want, or you can't even have empty spaces next to the smaller widgets. But this still feels like a step in the right direction. Other than the date and weather widget, I don't use too many of them even on my Android phones, so I'm not too sure if I'm going to use a lot of them on my iPhone. But it is still nice to have more information being displayed on the home screen. It saves us extra step of going within a particular app just to glance at one thing. Since I can stack multiple widgets on top of each other in iOS 14, I might end up using them more without sacrificing a lot of space on my homepage. Yes, you can stack widgets on top of each other. You can either use a smart stack widget provided by Apple, and it changes or displays the relevant widget depending on the time of the day or your location. Or you can just stack a couple of widgets of your choice on top of each other and just swipe between them. You can also convert your custom widget into a smart stack. Just long tap on it, select Edit Stack, and then turn on the Smart Rotate option. Right now, these widgets are only available for Apple apps, but I am expecting third-party apps to bring in their widgets as well, which would be much more useful in my opinion. On the rightmost page, you now get App Library, which contains all of your apps. Since all the apps that you installed on your phone are here, you can go ahead and remove the ones that you don't use too often from your home screen to make it look a bit cleaner. When you need to use those apps, just go to the App Library and open it from there. The first folder in this library are suggested apps, then you have the recent used ones, and then all of the remaining apps are clubbed into various categories. Now I haven't organized my home screen yet, but this way I can just have one home screen with a couple of widgets and some of my most used apps. All of the other apps could be hidden in App Library instead of occupying multiple folders or pages. One of the coolest features that Apple has added in iOS 14 is the Back tab. This is buried deep in accessibility settings, but with this feature, you can assign various actions when you tap on the back of your phone. You can just tap the back of your phone twice, maybe to lock the phone, and tap three times to take a screenshot. These are just a couple of examples, but there is a whole list of actions that you can assign to these tabs. It is like having the functionality of extra buttons on your phone that you can assign various tasks to without actually having the physical buttons. I just wish that the response was a bit faster and that Apple refines it a bit more in the next update. Because now it takes a second or so to actually take a screenshot or lock the phone if I double tap or triple tap the phone. And sometimes it just won't recognize the tap, so I will have to do it multiple times. Next up, there is Compact UI. A part of this is the new alert interface for incoming calls. Up till iOS 13, if you get a call while you are doing something on your phone, it took up the whole screen and became a very big distraction. But starting with iOS 14, we finally get smaller banner-like notifications for incoming calls. This is no more a distraction and you can take or cut the call with these buttons or just swipe it up and get back to what you were doing. You can also tap on the banner to make it full screen if you want. I like that we get a much smaller, non-intrusive notification for the incoming calls. But I'm not sure I like that it is displayed at the top of the screen. Now this phone is the iPhone 11 Pro Max and due to the huge display, I have to extend my hands all the way up to the top to take or reject the call. If the incoming call happens to be a FaceTime video call, you can just take the call, swipe up and continue looking at other things on your screen while the FaceTime call is now a floating picture-in-picture window which you can move around. Previously, if you swipe up or went to the home screen while on a FaceTime call, the other person on the call just saw a blurry screen or a message that the video is on hold. Now you can continue the video and multitask at the same time. To help you actually multitask better, picture-in-picture is also available while watching videos. If you're watching Apple TV videos or any other video in the Safari browser in full screen, you can just swipe up and the video just turns into a floating PIP window which you can move around the screen as you're doing some other work. You can change the size of this window and even move it off the screen completely while the audio is still playing in the background. When I said you can move the window around, you can't just place it anywhere on the screen. You can just move it to any of the four corners or the top or bottom of the screen depending upon the size of the viewer. Now this is not yet supported by the YouTube app that is on your iPhone. So to play YouTube videos in PIP mode, open up YouTube in Safari browser, choose the video that you want to watch, hit the full screen button and then swipe up from the bottom to enter the PIP mode. Hopefully YouTube will update their app to support this feature by the time iOS 14 comes out in September or October. Just like with the incoming calls, Siri also doesn't take up the full screen anymore and it also gets a new animation. Now when you bring up Siri, it is a small animation which sits at the bottom of the screen above whatever you are doing. Although you can see what is going on the screen behind Siri, you can't interact with it. The information that Siri was giving you goes away the moment you tap on anything that is behind the Siri interface. And right now, you can't swipe up to see the earlier responses like you can do on previous versions of iOS. This is still in beta, and I'm sure Apple is working on ways to make Siri results appear in a better way. Another awesome feature is the sleep mode. This is primarily for Apple Watch, but you can enable it on your iPhone as well. Once you turn this on and put in your sleep schedule, it enables a simplified lock screen and turns on Do Not Disturb mode, so you're not distracted and your sleep is not interrupted by constant notifications. I stumbled on this while going through all of the apps, and I don't think anyone else is talking about this, so I made sure to include it in my video. There are some cool changes to the camera as well. If you go into settings and scroll down to the camera settings, there is now an option to mirror the front-facing camera. I can't tell you how many guys ask me how to do this every time I post a video about iPhone's camera. Now you know. And right below that option, there is the option to disable the view outside the frame. I have been praying to get this option ever since I got the iPhone 11 and 11 Pro. Now before this option, whenever you open your camera, the interface showed you the view outside the frame that you can capture with the wide lens. I thought it was incredibly distracting, and I'm so happy that we finally have a way to turn it off. Next up, we now have a separate option to adjust the exposure within the camera app. And the Quick Take Video option is now available for all iPhones running iOS 14. Previously, it was only available for iOS 11 series phones and the new iPhone SE. You can also change the video resolution and the frame rate option right from within the camera app on older iPhones. Previously, this was also only available for iPhone 11 series phones and the new iPhone SE. While I was in the camera app, you might have noticed this green light at the top. This tells you whenever any app is accessing your camera. And there is an orange light when any app is accessing your microphone. You get notified of this even if the app is using the camera or microphone in the background, so this is a very cool little privacy feature. The Notes app also gets a few new features. While taking notes, you can now add various lines and grids to your notes like this. And if you are using the pen tool, just like on the new iPad OS, you can draw an outline of any particular shape and hold for just a second for it to be converted into a perfect shape, which is so cool. Now I don't know how many of you guys use the pen tool in the Notes app on your iPhone, because it is really hard to write with your fingers on this screen. So do these changes to the Notes app mean that we will see Apple Pencil support for the next iPhones? Maybe, we will have to wait and see. Next up, there is now an emoji search bar in the keyboard. You can now search for a particular emoji by typing on the keyboard instead of swiping through so many pages. Look how easy it is to find, for example, a car emoji like this, rather than searching it like this. There are some other features like the app clips, where you don't have to download the entire app to use a particular feature of it. The ability to finally change the default email and browser apps. This is not available in the current beta, but it is coming to iOS 14 when its final build will be released to all of the iPhone users. There is a stock translate app which supports a handful of languages right now, and there is also an on-device translate option in the Safari browser. Then there is a new interface for setting an alarm or setting time. While this way is much faster, I'm still going to miss the scroll dials, especially the haptic feedback that they give. In the App Store, you get all the information like who the developer is and the size of the app right below the download or update button. Earlier, you had to scroll all the way to the bottom of the page to get this info. As I started making this video, I found out that there are so many new changes throughout the user interface, including but not limited to some really cool features for the messaging app, like the ability to pin 9 conversations at the top. You also get inline reply threads and mentions in the messaging app. There are also some major speed improvements to the camera app and a few additions and customizations to the home app. There are privacy enhancements where the app has to ask your permission for tracking. Apple Maps gets a few enhancements and few features like bike trails and EV routing in some countries. Some major redesign is coming to the Apple Music app and so much more. But it is hard to cover every single one of these updates in this video. Broadly speaking, the ones that you guys saw in this video were some of the major ones that you guys should know about. If you guys want a more extensive list of iOS 14 features, let me know in the comments, and maybe if we get enough comments, I will make a list of top 100 iOS 14 features or something like that. There are so many new features that it is going to be hard to keep a track of them, and eventually, most people will end up using just a bunch of them. But that doesn't mean I am not happy about all the new changes and features in iOS 14. Some of my favorites are the stacked widgets, back tap, and the small changes that are coming to the camera app. Which one of these are your favorite new features of iOS 14? Let me know in the comments. That is it for this video, guys. Please hit the like button if you enjoyed this video and subscribe to the channel for more quality tech videos like this. You can also check out some of the other videos from this channel. This has been Sagar, and I'll catch you guys in the next video. Take care.